G'day guys, welcome back to another episode of True Footy Reacts. Last week we took a break from True Footy Reacts while Bush and I got together to do a True Footy podcast. So if you haven't checked that out, you should. You'll find it a couple of episodes back on this channel. But I am back this week and today we're going to cover a few of the more pressing issues coming out of rounds 10 and 11. First up, we're going to deal with the breaking news that actually popped up while I was preparing for this video. So after an extended period of Damien Barrett having a crack at Brendan Bolton, it appears the Blues have folded under the pressure and have sacked their coach. I must admit, I was defending Bolton not too long ago and I said that wins and losses shouldn't be the driving metric in his performance. And to be fair, that's kind of true. They've been rebuilding a rebuild since about 2016 and their list has always been really young. The list that Bolton took over was actually ratchet, so you can't really expect him to do too much with it too soon. That being said, he's won just 4 of the last 43 as coach and even some of the more patient Carlton supporters are starting to get a bit over it. For me, what I think is telling is that the Blues have actually been that much worse than Gold Coast over the last 2 years, and I think that's an absolute indictment. The Suns have been through more adversity than the Blues, and going into this year, some people said it was the worst AFL list ever assembled. Obviously, that's an exaggeration, but at the same time, Gold Coast sit 2 wins ahead of the Blues, and their consistency of effort has been a lot better than Carlton's this year. When I think about what Stuart Dew has been able to achieve so far at Gold Coast this year, it does make me think maybe Brendan Bolton does need to go. Some will make the argument that not too many coaches would be doing better than Brendan Bolton at the moment with the list that they have, but when you look at the numbers, it's hard to imagine anyone doing worse. I do feel for Bolton and I do hope he coaches again. I do feel as though he's been given a bit of a shit hand and it was always going to be a tough ask to lift that team into being competitive. But we must move on. Last week, the AFL had its first ever mid-season draft. Now, undoubtedly, the rationale for this draft was to help clubs cover their injuries that they sustained at the start of the year and be able to recruit a mature age player who can slot straight in and fill a role. A perfect example of this was Tom Mitchell breaking his leg at the start of the year and Hawthorn going into the season a man down. I mean, I think some clubs approach the draft in that spirit. You had the Bulldogs already have a debutant, Carlton had Josh DeLuca, Port and Melbourne also had guys who were ready to play next week. But on the other hand, Fremantle took a project player in Dylan O'Reilly. Richmond took Marlon Pickett, who's probably not going to play a game this year because he's already injured. And St Kilda picked up Jack Mayo, and if I understand correctly, he was dropped from his Waffle senior side last week. Don't get me wrong, I think these clubs have the right to use the draft any way they please. But I guess my point is that the clubs clearly aren't investing in the draft in the way that the AFL had intended the draft to be used. I think we've seen time and time again, clubs are actually pretty unwilling to invest in mature age talent. Personally, I think the idea of a mid-season draft and even the supplementary list thing is a bit of a waste of time. It's great for the players because they have a potential career in the AFL, but it's shit for the state league club that they leave, and I think the instances where it actually helps an AFL team are going to be pretty few and far between. Personally, I do kind of like the idea that you have your traditional draft and trade period as the time where you have to strategically plan for the next season. There's always going to be injuries, but you need to have your list prepared and have enough depth in that area so you can cover it. I like that idea as part of the strategy. Having things like the mid-season draft kind of takes away from that, and I guess I don't really like it. That's just my take. I mean, I'm happy for the players that have their dreams realized, but personally, I would probably scrap the whole thing next year. Now, back onto the actual football, and it does appear as though North Melbourne are having a bit of resurgence. I actually reckon you can make the argument that this jump up in form isn't to do that much with the coach, but it's actually been building for a few weeks now. Not too long ago, they finished really strongly against Port. They pants Carlton. They pushed the Cats all the way and then beat the Dogs. This week, they absolutely pants Richmond. To be honest, North looked like a class above all night. I firmly believe that they would have beaten most sides in the competition with the way they played on Friday night. They played with intent, they moved the ball quickly, and what was most impressive for me was the way they used the handball to get out of trouble. Now, it may be the case that things were a bit stale at the club and they probably needed a change at the top to instill a bit of freshness, but like I said, I think this form has been building for a while and they're starting to show the form that some people expected them to play all throughout this year. Now, on the topic of upsets, Fremantle have collected their second big scalp for the year, stunning the Magpies at the MCG on Saturday. It's a result that no one tipped, but personally I think it's a bit of a case of the Pies being due for a loss. In recent weeks, I think they've kind of just done enough to get the points, and it was only a matter of time before a team caught them napping. I don't mean to take anything away from Fremantle though, because they were sublime. They've also proved it's not a fluke, because they beat GWS away from home earlier this year as well. A lot of Fremantle's heavyweights are doing a lot of the work at the moment. We've mentioned Fife, we've mentioned Luke Ryan, Alex Pierce, David Mundy, but another player who's having a brilliant season is Brad Hill, and he could arguably be winning their best and fairest right now. I'm hoping that Alex Pierce's injury isn't as bad bad as it looked. It didn't look great, but he's an integral part of the defense, so that'll be a massive blow if he goes down. As a cruel reward for the Dockers, they actually slide out of the eight despite that win due to Port's massive win in China. Nonetheless, it's still a huge win for them in the context of their season, and finals is definitely a realistic aim now. Now, as much as I've been talking up the D's as still a smoky to make the finals, I think they're absolutely cooked now. On the weekend, they led the Crows by as much as 31 points in the third term before conceding 8 of the last 9 goals to lose by 2 points. The fact that they just kicked 1 goal 8 in that final term tells the story. The Demons have forgotten how to win. For me, I think the personnel is good enough. I think the coach is good enough, so there's no need for some hysteria there. There's been some talk this year that they shouldn't have traded Hogan because they're missing him right now, but I mean, if you look at the form that Hogan's in right now, I don't think they're missing him too much. It appears that going into the season as unfit as they were has absolutely cooked them, because losing the games at the start of the season that they did would have knocked their confidence, and it's obviously had a flow-on effect. With finals probably out of the question now, I don't think they should go into full development mode. They just need to keep their heads down and grind out the rest of the season. Maybe it's a good opportunity to give some opportunities to some of the younger guys, but they really just need some continuity and keep their best players playing and get them into form. Now, after an alarmingly bad early to middle round part of the season, the Eagles are slowly starting to build towards becoming a contending side again. Now, they had 2 good wins in a row against the Demons and Crows, but they didn't really play their champagne football. They really just ground out really tough, come from behind victories. Against the Doggies, however, we saw them get off the leash a little bit and absolutely bully them in the third term, kicking 9 goals, which I think will do a lot for their confidence and their percentage. Now, Jack Darling's been struggling a little bit this year. It's hard to diagnose whether that's because he's out of form or if it's because our inside 50s have been actual butthole. That being said, he returned to form a little bit, took some really strong marks and kicked 6 goals. For me, I think a lot of the driving force of the recent success has come from the midfield trio of Gaff, Shuey and Yeo. They've been brilliant in recent weeks. I did underestimate the Eagles. They find themselves in the top 4 with Geelong, Collingwood and GWS, and they probably deserve to be there at the moment. Now, Stephen Cornelio is continuing his career best season, and he was unanimously voted our True Footy Player of the Round. He had a mammoth 3 goal and 36 possession game, which saw him score 192 fantasy points. If you're on our league and you had him in your team, I hate you. You suck. What is really clear is that the Giants are a side that are really conducive to players getting off the chain and destroying other teams. Guys like Whitfield, Cameron, even Finlayson have had absolute days out. Taranto, Hopper, Cornelio, they're all massive fantasy players as well. But Cornelio, with that perfect round, goes to the top of our True Footy Player of the Year award. Brody Grundy remains second. Travis Boak slips into equal fifth with a best on ground performance against St Kilda in China. Speaking of Travis Boak, his 2 goal and 33 possession game was enough to earn him 3 votes from me in China. He's now locked with Tim Kelly on top of the Phantom Brownlow count with 16 votes. The other players to receive 3 votes from us this week include Cunnington, Cornelio, Fife, Dangerfield, Lyons, Crouch, Heppel, and Darling. Now it's time for the footy tipping shout out. This week, most people scored 7, but no one did better than Shimida Beast. I apologise for pronouncing that incorrectly. He scored 7 with the margin of 46. No one tipped North Melbourne to win, so he just tipped Richmond to win by the least. But our overall leader is still my nemesis, Farmer Wants a Fife with 69 and a total margin of 343. So well done, mate. In terms of fantasy, Chad Booth is our leader with an incredible 2369 this week. That is absolutely filthy. But his average is 2203 for the year, which is incredible. I am no chance of catching him now. I'm still languishing in 65th or something like that. Anyway, guys, that's all we have time for today. I'm hoping to get my footy tips video out sometime later this week. Also, on my personal channel, Jesse Thomas, go subscribe if you haven't already. I'll be doing a vlog of the West Coast Western Bulldogs game that I went to at Optus Stadium. So if you're interested, go subscribe and check it out when it comes out later this week. Sorry to do this again, but I can't guarantee a True Footy Reacts next week. I am in my final exam period of my life, hopefully, if I pass. So I may skip another Monday or two before that's finished in a couple of weeks. Sorry, guys. But I'll still be keeping up my weekly tips video at the very least. Thanks for watching the video, guys. If you enjoyed it, please throw me a like or subscribe if you haven't already. I'll see you next time on the True Footy YouTube channel. Cheers.